Okay, welcome. 1 week from tomorrow will be the eclipse, and I think we're all excited for that. Our presenter today is Karen Hare. She's a retired astronomer, a NASA contractor, university professor, and now she is a volunteer at Cape Perpetua. Karen? Thank you, Jenny, and I want to give special thanks to Scott Gordon for all the work that he did in putting together the projector and other equipment. And I want to thank all of you for coming. I'm pleased to be here today to return to my astronomy roots and share with you a preview of a big coming attraction. In just over a week, on the morning of August 21st, we will, weather gods permitting, see one of nature's grandest shows, a total eclipse of the sun. Have any of you seen a total eclipse before? Wow, quite a few, actually. Surprising, but certainly not everyone, because the last one visible in the United States occurred 38 years ago.
I was there.
You're telling us your age. Have any of you seen a partial eclipse? Quite a few more. So we do have some eclipse veterans. Some words that I've encountered to describe a total eclipse of the sun include marvelous, spectacular, breathtaking, awesome, sight of a lifetime, and I'm sure you'll add your own. I know most of you have been reading about the eclipse, and perhaps you've already learned a lot. But today I'd like to add some more, hopefully to increase your knowledge and enjoyment of the big event. So, this works. I will be talking about what a solar eclipse is, a short history of eclipse watching, and that fascinating topic could be a talk in itself, so I will have to be brief. What causes eclipses, the scientific stuff, when and where to watch the eclipse, what you will see in the sky and all around you, then the most important topic of all, how to watch the eclipse without hurting your eyes, so please stay to the end to hear that. And if you do stay, then I will tell you some places you can go to find more information. So let's start with, what is a solar eclipse? Here is Sol, our sun, the light of our lives. The eclipse starts when the dark new moon moves in front of Sol, blocking our view, taking a bigger and bigger bite out of the sun, until, if the eclipse is total, then for a few minutes, the sun disappears, and the sky is dark as night. But then, in the darkness, amazing things appear, including unusual lights and colors. We can see the sun's beautiful outer atmosphere, the corona. Then, everything happens in reverse. The moon moves away, revealing more and more of the sun, until once again, Sol is back to his bright and happy self. Now, you may be thinking that the sun is much larger than the moon, 400 times as large. So how can our small moon block the big sun? Does anyone know the answer? Distance, that's right. The sun is also 400 times farther away, which means that the sun and the moon have almost exactly the same apparent size in the sky, and that means the moon can block the sun. Oops, that effect is shown in this picture. As in all of my diagrams, distance and size are not drawn exactly to true scale, but this is a schematic to show that if the Earth
and the moon and the sun are precisely aligned,
and the moon and the sun have the
same angular size,
then a person on the Earth, oops, or pushed the wrong button, then a person on the Earth at the position of the arrow will see the sun totally blocked for a total eclipse.
Now, the distance to the moon is not completely constant. It varies by as much as 6%. And the distance to the sun varies too, but by a smaller amount.
In this diagram, the moon
is a bit farther away,
and it blocks only the
central part of the sun.
So our eclipse observer
sees a bright rim around the dark moon for what's known as an annular eclipse.
We had an annular
eclipse here in Oregon about 5 years ago. Some of you might recall that.
Another type of eclipse occurs when the moon and the sun are not
exactly aligned,
and the moon covers only an off-center part of the sun for a partial eclipse.
Now, there's always a partial eclipse phase just before and after a total or annular eclipse, but sometimes partial is all we get. I will be explaining why these alignments and eclipses happen, but first I'd like to take a trip back in time to consider how, through the ages, people have watched and contributed to our understanding of eclipses.
The first known record of an eclipse is from China, for an eclipse that occurred in 2136 BC. For the ancient Chinese, the sudden disappearance of the sun evoked fear and dread. They thought that the sun was being eaten by a giant dragon. So to frighten the beast away, they made loud noises and they beat the ground with sticks. And by golly, it always worked. The sun was saved. The Babylonians were able to predict eclipses accurately as far back as 1700 BC. By careful observations over hundreds of years, they learned that eclipses repeat at definite intervals. Their observations were recorded on clay tablets, such as this one. For the Babylonians, eclipses were closely associated with religious events. The Mayans in Central America were keen observers and predictors of eclipses as early as 300 AD. They too believed that astronomical events had religious significance and influenced everyday life. Observations were made by priest astronomers who worked in observatories in temples that were aligned to monitor the position of astronomical bodies. Their observations were recorded on bark paper documents called codices, some of which have survived, like this one from the 11th century. It was the ancient Greeks who took our understanding of eclipses from the supernatural to the natural realm. By 200 BC, they had figured out that eclipses are caused by the moon moving in front of the sun. Greek astronomy culminated with the work of Ptolemy, who devised a model for circular motions of the planets. But Ptolemy's model was not quite correct. It had all the planets and the sun revolving about the Earth. It was to later Europeans that we owe our present knowledge of the solar system and eclipses. The Polish astronomer Nicholas Copernicus is usually given credit for establishing that the sun is the center of the solar system. But the heliocentric idea actually goes back as far as ancient Greek, but it was only after the publication of Copernicus's model that it became generally accepted. But even Copernicus's model was not exactly correct. To accurately predict planetary motions and eclipses,
he had to add to the primary circular motion motions in little circles called epicycles. And he thought that the solar system stayed intact because the planets were all attached to transparent rotating spheres. It was the German mathematician and astronomer, Johannes Kepler, who did away with the epicycles by showing that planetary orbits are actually slightly flattened circles, called ellipses. But Kepler still didn't understand what holds the planets in their orbits. That final piece of the story was supplied by the English scientist Isaac Newton, who showed that the force of gravity holds the solar system together. By the 1600s, we had all the science now needed to understand eclipses. But until the mid-1800s, the only recorded eclipse images were observer sketches, often very painstakingly drawn, such as this one by the English astronomer William Rutter Dawes. This event was also the first one to be photographed. And here is the original photograph taken by a Russian named Bukowski. Photography was to become an important tool for studying eclipses, but still I can't help but think that in this case, the drawing better captured the drama of the event. With the advent of photography and advanced instrumentation, eclipses became anticipated opportunities for scientific study. A famous example is the so-called Einstein eclipse of 1919. Albert Einstein predicted in his general theory of relativity that light particles called photons have mass, and they should be attracted to other massive bodies. But because the mass of a photon is so very small, no change in its motion can be seen unless it gets close to a very massive body, like the sun. Now, the light from some stars passes close to the sun, but usually we can't see stars in the bright sky close to the sun. However, in darkness, during a total eclipse, they become visible. So the English astronomer, Arthur Eddington, who is shown here with Einstein, sent two groups to observe the 1919 eclipse and photograph stars seen near the sun. What they found was that the stars were shifted from their usual positions in the photographs because their light was bent, passing close to the sun. And the amount of the shift was exactly what was needed to confirm Einstein's theory. Now, after the work of many scientists over thousands of years, we finally have all the tools that we need to understand why and when eclipses happen. Basically, it's a matter of orbital motions and geometry. You all remember geometry, don't you? But don't worry, it's not hard. Two things to remember about astronomical bodies is that they're always in motion, and generally they move in circles. The Earth travels around the Sun once a year in a nearly circular orbit that lies on a plane called the ecliptic plane, which would be the plane of this screen. The Moon accompanies the Earth around the Sun and also revolves around the Earth once a month in an orbit that is nearly a circle and nearly in the ecliptic plane. I say the orbits are nearly circles because actually they're slightly flattened circles, those Keplerian ellipses. That's why distances to the Moon and the Sun vary just a bit. The Earth also spins around an axis, So a person on the Earth undergoes yet another circular motion around the axis once a day. Now, if all this going around in circles hasn't made you dizzy, let's now concentrate on the motion of the moon. One half of the spherical moon is always illuminated by the sun. And as the moon orbits around the Earth, we see different portions of the sunlit and dark sides, the familiar phases of the moon. When the moon is opposite the sun in the sky, we see only the right side. This is called full moon. When the moon is seen in the same direction as the sun, we see only the dark side. This is called new moon. It is only at the time of new moon that the moon can block the sun and cause a solar eclipse. Actually, there is one other type of eclipse, a lunar eclipse, that occurs at full moon when the moon enters the Earth's shadow. But I won't be talking about that today. When I say eclipse, I will always mean solar eclipse, and that means a new moon. Now, we have a new moon every month, yet we don't have a solar eclipse every month. Does anyone know why? Speak up. Well, that's getting close. The answer is that an eclipse requires a precise alignment of the moon and the sun. But the moon's orbit does not lie exactly in the plane of the Earth's orbit, the ecliptic plane. It's tilted by 5 degrees. In this diagram, the solid line shows the part of the moon's orbit that is above the ecliptic plane, and the dotted line shows the part that's below that plane. But an eclipse requires a new moon. When the moon is in this position here, it lies above the plane. So an observer on the Earth will see the moon above the sun, and there won't be an eclipse. Now, will there ever be a new moon which is in the right position? There can only be an eclipse when the moon is at one of two points where it crosses the ecliptic plane. These points are called nodes. The line in the ecliptic plane connecting the nodes is called the line of nodes. That line will be important in this story. Will there ever be a new moon when the moon is at one of the nodes? Here it doesn't look possible, but the answer is actually yes, because the orientation of the moon's orbit in space stays fixed as the Earth and the moon orbit the sun. And in another 3 months, the line of nodes will point toward the sun, and a new moon can then occur at a node and cause an eclipse. But will there ever be a new moon when the nodes point toward the sun? Again, the answer is yes. The time period when the line of nodes is sufficiently close to the sun for there to be at least a partial eclipse is called an eclipse season. It lasts somewhere between 31 and 37 days. But we have a new moon every 29 and a half days. So there will definitely be one new moon and one eclipse during the season, and possibly two new moons and two eclipses. But only one of those could be total. Then, in 6 months, the nodes will again align with the sun for another eclipse season, another eclipse, possibly two more, and possibly one of them total. So now we are seeing that within any 1 year period, there are at least two eclipses, possibly four, and possibly two of them could be total. But there's more. The moon's line of nodes is not exactly fixed in space. Like everything else, it's rotating. Slowly, but enough, so that the next eclipse season occurs not after 6 months, but 18 days earlier. And this is enough time for one more eclipse within the year. And it could possibly be a total eclipse. So now you understand all about the frequency of eclipses. Why within any 1 year period we have at least two solar eclipses, possibly as many as five, and possibly three total eclipses. Now each of these eclipses will be visible from some portion of the Earth's surface. But exactly where are they seen? A solar eclipse occurs only when the moon's shadow reaches the Earth. The shadow has two parts, a dark part called the umbra and an outer penumbra. Everyone who is within the umbra sees the sun completely blocked for a total eclipse. Everyone who is in the penumbra sees a partial eclipse. Now the umbra is less than 67 miles wide, or 167 miles wide, excuse me, at the Earth's surface, and usually at a smaller. In next week's eclipse, the umbra will be a 65 by 70 mile eclipse. The penumbra has a radius of 2,000 to 3,000 miles. This is a NASA photograph of the moon shadow seen from space during a total eclipse. The dark spot contains the umbra. But as you know, the moon is not standing still. As it orbits the Earth, the shadow sweeps through space. The total eclipse begins when the umbra first touches the Earth. Then the umbra moves eastward across the Earth, tracing a path, shown here in red, inside of which everyone sees the total eclipse. The moon and its shadow move at a very high velocity of 2,100 miles per hour. However, the Earth is also rotating in the same direction at a speed of 1,000 miles per hour at the equator. So for a person on the equator, the moon's shadow moves past at a speed of 1,100 miles per hour. At places away from the equator, it moves even faster. And it moves fastest of all if the moon is near the horizon, where it can reach 5,000 miles per hour. But because of the shadow's small size and large speed, the eclipse can't last very long in any one place. The maximum possible duration is 7.5 minutes. Next week, at most places on the eclipse path, the total eclipse will last about 2 minutes. The partial phase can last 4 hours, but next week only 2.5 hours at any one place. The eclipse ends when the shadow reaches the edge of the Earth, and then the shadow moves again out into space. Now, this brings us to the discussion of where and when to watch the upcoming eclipse. I will now play a NASA video simulation of the moon shadow moving across the United States next week. The eclipse starts out in the Pacific Ocean. Here the penumbra has reached the United States. Here comes the umbra rushing in at 3,000 miles an hour. It quickly crosses Oregon, Idaho, Wyoming, Nebraska. It slows down a little bit in the center of the country, but then it goes across Missouri, parts of Illinois, Kentucky, Tennessee, North Carolina, leaving the country at the coast of South Carolina. The umbra moves out into the Atlantic Ocean, where it leaves the Earth. But the penumbra and the partial eclipse will reach parts of Europe and Africa.
Now, that was very fast, so let's go back and look again at the eclipse path. The red line is the path of totality. The total eclipse will be visible for 1.5 hours within the United States, and the partial phase for 4 hours. Totality starts at 10:15 in the morning on the Oregon coast, and it ends at 2:45 local time near Charleston, South Carolina. Everyone in the United States will see at least a 50% eclipse. The longest duration of totality is along the center line of the eclipse. It's longer in the center of the country because the moon is overhead and the shadow is moving slower. The maximum duration will be 2 minutes and 41 seconds in southern Illinois. With more than 20 million people living in the eclipse path and millions more visiting, this is predicted to be the most viewed astronomical event in history, the Great American Eclipse. Let's zoom in on the eclipse path in Oregon. First the whole state, and then the coast. The moon's umbra makes landfall near Depot Bay and spends 11 minutes crossing the state. The center line, where the duration is about 2 minutes, passes between Corvallis and Salem, and then to the east by Madras and John Day, which are said to have the best weather prospects. I will be watching the eclipse just south of Salem in my cousin's horse field. On the Oregon coast, the center line is between Lincoln City and Depot Bay, where the eclipse starts at 9:04 in the morning and lasts for 2.5 hours. Totality starts at 10:15 and lasts for 1:59. The eclipse is total for at least a short time, every place between Northern Wallport and Pacific City. But wherever you watch the eclipse, you want to position yourself for an unobstructed view of the sun in the southeast at 40 degrees elevation. And be sure to reach your chosen spot early, because traffic may be gridlocked. In Yahats, the eclipse is only 99.9% total. Sorry, guys. A small sliver of the sun will always be visible, and it's never safe to watch it without proper eye protection, which we will talk about shortly. Just this morning, looked at the long-range weather forecast, and right now they're predicting sunny skies throughout the state on the morning of the 21st. But that can change, because after all, the weather gods do not read the forecast. Of course, we are all hoping for perfect weather, but in case we miss this event, there is an opportunity for another countrywide eclipse in 7 years. This line is the upcoming eclipse next week, and the diagonal line is the eclipse in 7 years. Unfortunately, that one won't be seen in Oregon, but the folks in the Northeast should have a great view. And then, in 2045, if we're still here, there will be an eclipse path very similar to the one next week, but slightly farther to the south. And unfortunately, that one, too, is going to miss Oregon. So let's assume you've found your perfect spot, and the big event is about to begin. What can you expect to see? This impressive time-lapse sequence of photos for an eclipse in 2012 is a close representation of what we should see next week in Oregon. It shows the sun rising in the east, and the moon covering first the western part of the sun, and then the progression of total and final partial phases. It also shows sunset color, which you might notice all around you on the horizon. This comes from places in the distance that are outside the moon's shadow, but experiencing a partial eclipse with light that comes from a thin crescent of the sun's lower atmosphere that emits a reddish light. You might also notice that the ground and the sky are darker in the west as the moon's shadow approaches. Remember, the shadow is moving very fast, so you'll have to look quickly for that. As the moon covers more and more of the sun, you will look and feel the signs of approaching nightfall. The air temperature may drop as much as 10 degrees. Birds may stop singing and go to roost. Flowers may begin to close. Stars and planets will become visible, including Venus, Jupiter, and Mars. And then, a few seconds before totality, the last sliver of the sun flashes as a bright spot called the diamond ring. There are other bright spots called Bailey's beads that may appear briefly around the rim of the darkening sun. These are caused by light streaming through peaks and valleys on the moon's surface. With the disappearance of Bailey's beads, you can and should remove your eye protection for the most splendid sight of all. The majestic solar corona flashes into view. The corona is the tenuous, superheated, million-degree outer atmosphere of the sun. It is driven a million miles into Earth by tumultuous motions of gas on the sun's surface. It is shaped into streamers by the sun's magnetic field. The shape of the corona varies during the 11-year cycle for solar activity. When the sun is most active, the corona seems round. When the sun is less active, it has a greater extent in the direction of the sun's equator. Now, because we're approaching a minimum in solar activity, we may see in a corona that's somewhat more elliptical than what's shown in this photo. The corona is usually hidden by bright sunlight, but it becomes visible to the naked eye during an eclipse. Until the development of special sun-blocking instrumentation, total eclipses were anticipated opportunities for scientific study. For instance, the element helium was discovered during a total eclipse before it was identified on Earth. Helios means sun. If you use binoculars or a telescope, which are only safe during totality, you may see more localized eruptions from the sun's surface, known as prominences. These are streams and arcs of gas glowing red in the light of ionized hydrogen. Like the corona, they are shaped by the sun's magnetic field, and they can rise tens to hundreds of thousands of miles above the sun's surface and last for days to months. At the end of totality, there will be one more opportunity to see Bailey's beads and the diamond ring. And then the event winds down with another partial eclipse for the next 80 minutes. The spectacular total phase of the eclipse will only have lasted for about 2 minutes, but hopefully your memories will last a lifetime. Now, the one thing that you must remember from this talk, how to watch the eclipse without burning your retinas.
if you want to look directly at the sun, and even a small sliver of the uneclipsed sun is visible, you need to use an approved solar filter, one that meets the ISO standard of removing 100% of the dangerous ultraviolet and infrared radiation, and 99.99% of the visible light. One alternative is eclipse glasses, and the inexpensive paper ones, which I have here, and which you can get over there, are perfectly adequate. But you must take care to protect them, not let them get scratched or broken. So I would recommend putting them inside an envelope. And be sure to test them so that you will know that the only thing you can see through them is the sun. Otherwise, they're not dark enough. An alternative to solar glasses during the partial phases are eclipse glasses. There are special eclipse glasses, like the ones I have here, very dark. Those were not terribly expensive, but you might not want to make the investment for something that you could use only once. But remember that ordinary sunglasses are not safe, even two overlapping pairs. And don't try using smoked glass. During totality, special filters that can be mounted on binoculars and telescopes, but those do tend to be very expensive. Yes?
You said once the corona is visible, you don't have to use glasses.
That's right. It's not very bright. Actually, the corona is only about as bright as the full moon. But as soon as the Bailey's beads appear again, you know that the bright sun is coming back, and you should put your eclipse glasses on again. But you can use binoculars during the total phase, but don't try to use binoculars with eclipse glasses during the partial phase, because the binoculars make the sun much brighter, and the eclipse glasses just simply are not adequate. An alternative way to see the eclipse is by projecting the sun's image onto the screen. That can be done with binoculars or a telescope. And another method is to make a pinhole camera, which consists of one sheet of paper with a small hole and another sheet for the screen. But this is not all that easy, because in order to get a decent sized solar image, two sheets have to be at least 5 feet apart. And I've never tried this myself. Other possibilities include indirect viewing. You can photograph the eclipse, but a special filter is needed so as not to damage your light meter. And I don't suggest spending too much time adjusting a camera during the eclipse, especially if this is your first eclipse, because you don't want to miss it in real time. And speaking of real time, the newest way to see the eclipse is via the internet. Now, NASA and others will be live streaming the event, but again, I suggest that you spend your time looking up at the sun and not down at your device. When the eclipse is over at your location, you can watch your device on the internet and see it as it becomes visible farther to the east. And of course, if we're unlucky enough to have clouds for the eclipse, this may be the only way that you'll be able to see it. Finally, I want to show you a few sites that you can visit for more information on the eclipse. Live streaming will be done through NASA, and there are also sites with animations that simulate the whole eclipse for any specified location. And I've listed a few places with general information, and one of the companies where you can buy eclipse glasses, which will not be necessary now because you can get them over there. And so I'm going to leave this up, and give those of you who want to stay longer a chance to ask questions. Are there any questions? Okay, we'll start here.
I assume since Dallas will get a total eclipse, you have to wear the glasses.
At all times, that's right.
How much exposure can you have to the sun without damage?
Oh boy, not for more than a few seconds.
A few seconds, 20 seconds?
Oh, I can't tell you for sure. You know that normally you wouldn't look at the sun for more than a couple of seconds, right? So I would just suggest always using the eclipse glasses and not try to risk it by timing.
So you have to go to Walport.
Northern Walport would only have a total eclipse for a few seconds. So I would suggest going to Newport or best Lincoln City or Depot Bay. But you won't be able to get there on the morning of the eclipse. So plan ahead. There would be a total eclipse anywhere from northern Walport up to Pacific City.
Where am I in northern Walport? I live in Walport, right on the LC. That's where I'm seeing my doctor.
Well, I'm not sure exactly where in northern. What you can go on to the internet at one of those animation sites. And if you know your latitude and longitude, you can put it in there and it'll tell you whether the eclipse is total, exactly how long it's total, where it will be in the sky, the whole thing.
So where I find my latitude and longitude.
Do you have a GPS? You can find it on there. Yes.
I have a map. I have a map on the internet.
Well, you have to wear, she asked when to put the glasses on and when to take them off. You have to wear the glasses or some other type of eye protection any time even a small part of the sun is visible. Okay. That does not include the corona. Okay. That some people take them off to see Bailey's beads, but that may not be safe. So it's best to, when you see Bailey's beads, if you see it, take them off. When you see Bailey's beads again, put them back on. Yes, exactly. Any other questions? Way in the back.
Does it help to go up in elevation if we were to go up in the mountains a little bit?
Well, one advantage of going up in elevation is that you might see the horizon. And there's this strange and weird effect of the sunset colors all around the horizon. So you might be able to see that. Yes?
Will it cause any kind of tide changes?
Well, yes. We always have high tides at the time of a new moon. And I have heard that the tide is going to be 9 feet on eclipse day. So that's going to be a king tide. Yes, in the way of that.
Do we have to worry about our animal's eye?
Do your animals normally look at the sun?
I don't know. If something unusual like an eclipse is happening, would they look at the sun?
Well, actually, I don't think the animals will be attracted to the eclipse. My dog likes to sit out on the sun deck and stare at the sun all day, so I have a little hat with a visor that I put on him. If you're really in doubt, get an extra pair of eclipse glasses. any other questions? Yes.
What are the chances that NASA's site's going to crash?
I'm afraid I can't answer that. I don't know. But if you go to the NASA site, they will tell you others. And I just heard on the TV the other night that CBS will be broadcasting the eclipse live. So check your television program. You may not have to go online. Yes.
I heard that there's some type of like snakes on the ground from shadows.
Oh, bands.
Bands.
Yeah, there are bands that if you have a light-colored surface, you may see waving bands across.
Yeah, they said it almost appears with shadow.
Yeah, and I didn't want to go into too much of that, but that's a kind of a refraction effect in the Earth's atmosphere from the very small sliver of the sun.
Any other questions? I guess that's it. Okay.